everybody, listen, just in case you didn't know, here is the meaning.
Our Father and our God, we come to say thank you, Lord, because thou hast spared us to see another day.
Yes.
Thank you.
We praise you because we're still in the land of the living. So many folk have gone on, but yet still you saw fit to keep us here to study your word. Bless us, Lord, and keep us under thy wings of love. Unite us together as one Christian band of love. Now, Lord, we pray for this gathering tonight of all the brethren and sisters that come together to uplift the name of Jesus. Yes. Let the anointing fall fresh upon us, Lord God, that we may move self out the way, but see all of thee. And Lord God, the facilitator, bless him, Lord, and keep him that he may open his mouth and speak the oracles of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, sir.
Amen.
At the end of the study last week, I was asked just what was the objective of this study? Just what was it I was trying to convey or bring out? And I wanted to kind of clear this up. Maybe I should have did this at the very first Sunday, but I thought it would be kind of obvious. But anyway, the study is designed to inform us of the different forms and postures of worship that the Bible teaches. The objective of this study is to make us better and more knowledgeable in our worship when we worship God. And of course, to elevate our worship, we first have to know God in a personal way. In a personal way. We have to know the object of our worship, just why and what makes that person or that entity worthy of praise, worthy of worship. I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bible with me, if you will, to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, verses number 22 and 23.
Amen.
Acts chapter 17, verses 22 and 23. Can somebody read that?
Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are very religious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship him, declare I unto you."
Amen. Amen. One of the first studies a few weeks back, we had the question, or we had the statement, that even sinners can worship. even sinners can worship.
Amen.
So, households that really don't know God, they can sit at a table before a meal and just say a prayer. Amen. But see, there's a such thing, and we'll get into it a little later, as unacceptable worship. Unacceptable worship. You can't truly worship or praise a God that you don't know. Amen. We got to have God in the proper position to be worshiped and praised. Listen, the more intimate your relationship is with God, the deeper your worship experience will be. Amen. Listen, in the Old Testament, in the Bible, David was a tremendous worshiper. I mean, he was phenomenal. And he used showed his admiration for God in a number of different ways. He wasn't stuck in just one way of worship. When we hear something, we just, hey, wave our hand, or, you know, that's all we got. David would sing. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, he would shout out loud. David was dancing. He danced naked. Mm-hmm. Amen. He even got on his knees, bowed on his knees before his God. Again, he was not stuck in one way of worshiping. And just like David, we have to set ourselves free to worship God. We can't be reserved. We can't worry about what the person sitting next to us might think or might say as we are praising God. Because see, I'm telling you, and I'm sure you already know, that each one of us has a point or a place in our lives where God met us. Mm-hmm. There were things going on in our lives. Things might have been going wrong in our life. Things could have been going very well in our lives at certain points. And when God came into our lives, every time we revisit that, when a preacher stands and he preaches about drugs and God took you off of that heroin, saved your life, whenever something like that comes up, then there's a feeling that comes through each one of us. That sometimes, a lot of times, we suppress. I'm not saying that we need to jump up and down on the pulpit and jump onto the communion table and do the James Brown. I'm not talking about that. But I'm talking about expression, being free to express praise and to express worship. Amen. Amen. We have to set ourselves free to worship our God. We got to prepare our hearts for this. We have to be prepared for worship. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, we got to block out all other distractions. We can't worry about who's wearing what in the church service, who's coming in real late, you know what I mean, who's talking over on the side instead of listening to the words of worship in the service. We have to be focused on God, solely on God, block out all the other distractions. We have to be prepared. Now I'm going to ask y'all to turn somewhere with me. Nehemiah chapter 9. Nehemiah chapter number 9. Nehemiah chapter number 9, verse 1 and 2. Yeah, verses 1 and 2. Somebody? Anybody?
Now, in the 24th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting and with sackcloths and earth upon them. And the seed of Israel separated themselves from all strangers and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers.
Amen. Amen. See, now in this, we have to notice that the Israelites prepared themselves for worship. Mm-hmm. They cast off anything other than that which would distract them, anything that would distract them from focusing on and worshiping their God. They didn't just fall out of bed and head to the service. as often happens in churches today. A lot of us, well, I'm not going to say us per se, I'm not speaking about anyone in particular, but a lot of folk don't take much thought in preparation, the preparation of worship. Amen. Even though we should always be in a state of or have an open door and an open mind to God and to be always in conversation, always in the presence of God, always aware of who God is in our lives as we move in all things, acknowledge him. Amen. Amen. But a lot of times we don't prepare our hearts and prepare our minds to worship. And then when we get into the service, and you know, at the end of the service, we wind up saying things like, I didn't get much out of that. Or, you know, or the word wasn't strong, or I didn't, you know, and why does this happen? It happens in part because we're not prepared to worship. We're not prepared to worship. As the scriptures is demonstrated in the scriptures in Matthew. Look at the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. And we all know this parable. We all know the parable of the sowers, of the different types of ground that the seed was thrown on. But see, nothing was wrong with the seed of the word. Nothing's wrong with the seed.
Amen.
The problem is with the ground of our hearts. Therefore, the seed couldn't, or the word couldn't penetrate because we were not prepared to receive it. It's just like with farming, the ground of our hearts must be cultivated to worship God. An unprepared worship can be an unacceptable worship. Now, I'm going to tell you what I mean by that. I'm going to tell you what I mean by that. There isn't an unacceptable worship. One of the studies, we looked at John chapter 4, where in verse number 23, Jesus said that, "But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit
and in truth.
And in truth. Mm-hmm. For the Father seeketh such to worship him." For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Now, the reality of this whole thing is that God the Father is seeking worshipers who worship in spirit and in truth. And that implies that there is both a wrong way
and a right way
to worship God. In fact, we can see the importance of it, of proper worship early on in the scriptures itself. Let's turn to Genesis chapter 4 for a minute. Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4. Let's do a little passage. Let's do 1-7. 1-7. Genesis chapter 4.
Genesis chapter 4, verses 1. "And Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstling of the flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect, And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him.
Amen.
Amen. And
why was Cain's offering rejected? Anybody?
No blood.
No blood. Amen. Because without blood,
there's no remission of sin.
There's no remission. There's no remission. It's improper. I mean, he was doing the proper thing. He actually came to offer, but he bought an improper offering. Amen. Sin lieth at the door. Amen. We see this happening a lot with Israel, with the children of Israel, in their history. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 5.
Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching to God. Wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? Wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and thou takest no knowledge? Behold, in the day of your fast, ye find pleasure and exact all your labors. Behold, ye fast for strife and debate, and to smite with the fist of wickedness. Ye shall not fast as ye do this day, to make your voice to be heard on high. Is it such a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Wilt thou call this a fast and an acceptable day to the Lord?
Amen.
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 They thought they were cool. They were fasting, but they had the wrong motivation. It was like saying, God, I don't like them, kill them, and fasting for it. Unacceptable worship. Amen. So how do we prepare ourselves for worship? One, we have to be prayed up. What else?
Focused on God.
Focused on God.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
You must have a true worship requires a total commitment of your body, mind, and spirit.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Gratitude. You're just thanking God for another day and for, you know, what he's carried you through. So you're just grateful.
Mm. Amen.
Amen.
Very good.
Very good.
Mm. An intimate relationship with God, who is the creator of the universe. Yeah, that intimate relationship.
Amen.
According to the scriptures we just read, confession of your sins.
Confession of your sins. Amen. Very good there, Deacon. Very good. Could it also include sacrifice? Sacrifice.
Same Lord.
Or anything that might be distracting you, just like if the football game was on right now, how you could be kind of looking out the side of your eye while you're talking to us.
Who you talking to, man?
hey, you know, I heard the old adage that if you throw a stone in a room full of people with no lights on, you can tell who it hits by who hollers.
My TV.
okay, it's not online. all right, brother.
But I do feel guilty for some reason.
Well, no, amen. You know what? I think that's it's kind of a trait of a Christian, because it's very often we feel as though we've fallen short, or that we have not met up to, or that we didn't do everything God laid before us. I guess we have the ideal of perfection because God is perfect, and we just can't meet up to that. Amen. But yes, sacrifice, I believe sacrifice is a part of worship. Surrender.
No, Reverend Reg. Reverend Reg, when you talk about sacrifice, are you talking about an offering or foregoing something?
Foregoing.
Foregoing, okay.
Yeah, foregoing. Again, like the football game, you know what I mean? Okay. Turn it off.
Okay.
And sacrifice it. Put it on the DVR.
So that how do you differ that from surrender?
Surrender is a act or form of humility, of humiliation. Surrender not holding any, like, well, look, everything you say is going to be all right unless you say this or if you say that. But surrender yourself to open yourself freely to whatever God would have for you or for you to do. Sacrifice and surrender is also a part of worship. It's a whole lot involved into that. Amen. Amen. We got to be other-minded.
Humility.
We can't be double-minded. We have to be other-minded. Amen. It's like when it comes to like attending a church service. And I know we're not inside right now, but when it comes to attending a church service, when you're going to church, try to get there on time. Try to get there on time. When you're rushing into the service and worship is already going on, you're not ready. You find yourself trying to catch up to what the Spirit is already doing in that place. Try to get it. You ever come into a movie 15 to 20 minutes after it started? You get lost. You can't tell up from down. You have to catch up to what the Spirit is doing. Some people, I've heard, try to get there at least by preaching time. They'll forego all the other stuff. You know, I mean, because, you know, my choir is not on this week. You know, so I'm not going to rush in there, you know, or the praise team, they singing these songs that I don't care that much about. So I kind of tune them out a little bit. You know, if those kind of things happen, then you got to ask yourself the question. Is this worship about me or is it about God? Is this worship about me or is it about God? You know what it's like? It's like bringing a nice gift to a birthday party to celebrate someone. And when you get there, you keep the gift for yourself. You don't share it. You don't express it. You don't open it. You keep it for yourself. Let me...
Can I ask a question?
There, go ahead, sir.
Exceptions, as you were saying about you shouldn't be late for church.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes in life there are exceptions or incidents that happen that you have no other choice. Okay. If you're about your father's business. So there is, I didn't lost all of y'all by the face, but I got to see how to bring y'all back in. That's okay. You see me though, right?
Yeah. You're the only one I can see.
Reverend Reggie is sharing his screen. Maybe that's why you see it differently.
Okay.
Yeah, but
that's not right.
Whoever's talking is the one that I see, and that's the only picture that I see. I got to get out of that mode.
That's interview.
Being late for service, there are exceptions. In other words, when the praise and worship is going on, some call it praise and worship, some call it devotional, some call it different things, but there are times when you just cannot be there because of the situation or an emergency that is going on that may slow you down or hinder you on your way.
Amen.
So out of no fault of your own, in other words.
Correct. You could be on your way to church and get a flat tire.
Well, what can you do about that, brother?
You can try to get you have to get the tire fixed so you can get there. So if you're late because of a situation, I mean, there are exceptions. That's what I was just saying.
Okay, all right. I got you. There's exceptions.
Right.
Exceptions to why you can't get to worship on time. But when you do get to worship a little bit late, then the effect of that is that you wind up a little behind what the Spirit is doing in the church. Okay?
Brother Reg?
No. Yes, sir.
What about the case of the man, the priest that walked by and saw the man who was beaten up and battered, and he walked right by
him because
he was on his way to church.
So what you do is you get out and walk, brother.
But I'm saying, rather than help the man, he went on to church because that was more important.
Yeah. Well, now you have to check that guy's motive, though. His motive, his motivation. Where was his heart at that particular point in time?
Well, should we bring this question home? You're on your way out your door to go to church. And your wife takes ill and she needs you. And
your wife did what?
She needs you, I said.
Oh.
I said, your wife needs you.
Okay.
So now are you going to just say, honey, I'll catch you on the way back? But being the man of the house, you're going to say, let me take care of home first.
Right, right.
So well, there are exceptions.
Okay, so let me say what I said in the beginning of all this, that when it comes to the church service, you should try to get there on time.
Amen.
So if you can't, you just can't.
Amen.
But you should try to get there on time.
Most affirmative.
Amen. Amen. I'm gonna get out of this because this ain't right. This is right. Okay. Worship again involves sacrifice, and it also involves surrender.
Amen.
And we should be free in our worship, not restrained or restricted. Let's look at some biblical worship. Okay. Somebody turn with me, would you please, to Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16. Verses 24 to 26.
Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed.
Amen. See, now, they were singing. They were singing God's praise. They were singing. But this wasn't an ordinary song service. And considering the fact that there was two men who were beaten. They were bruised. They were shackled. But their worship was pure. It was true worship. I mean, that's not easy to do, and I'm sure of it. When you've been thrown in a dungeon, when you've been beaten like that, when you're tied down like that. Amen. To sing, to start singing praises. That's acceptable worship, because you see what wound up happening. When those prison doors all slung wide open and they were loosed. Amen.
Extremacy and God's opportunity. Man did all he could do, couldn't do no more. So he had to lean on the Lord.
Amen. Amen. That's acceptable worship.
Amen.
Amen. Extreme. Something else. Let's go to Luke, the book of Luke, chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. Now, wait a minute. Now, that's a big passage. So let me. Luke chapter 7, starting with. Verse 36.
All the way down to 50.
36. Wow. It's getting late.
36 to 50.
Yeah. Yeah. Listen to this. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisees which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. Okay, I'm not gonna go into that one. I'm gonna stay there with that. With the woman with the alabaster box. Mm-hmm. amen, because of time. They said she was a sinner. But some of the greatest worship can come from the most unlikely source.
Yeah.
From the most unlikely. This woman was an outcast. She had been used and abused. But something about the words and actions of Jesus caused her to bring her most valuable possession and pour it out in an expression of love and worship in caring for Jesus. She pressed through fear, humiliation, prejudice, shame, in order to display her worship to Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's do one more. Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. Verses 41 to 43. Somebody, chapters 22, verses 41 to 43.
And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him.
Amen. Amen. Listen, on the evening of Jesus' arrest, he was praying, and he prayed for another option rather than the cross. Amen. But then he uttered the most amazing worship statement ever known when he said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. Sacrifice. Surrender. Amen. This is a statement of complete and total surrender, coming from the lips of Jesus himself. From the lips of Jesus himself. We're out of time. Next week, there's a word for praise. When we left last week, I asked you about your favorite president. And I'm not trying to get political. I know this is a highly stressful political period right now. But I'd asked about the name of your favorite president. And we had a couple of different answers. And next week, I'm going to tell you exactly why. Next week, I'm going to tell you exactly why I asked you that. And that's going to be the culmination of things. So I hope that you all will come back next week.
Said this was the week.
I know. And I better tell them why, she says.
Yes.
If I want dinner, I better do it.
Maybe the head, but she's the neck.
Amen. But listen to this. Listen to this. There is a word for praise that is the same as the name of the 44th president of the United States.
Yeah. Amen.
Barack.
Amen.
Yes, sir. And see, it's tough for a transliteration, a translation, to bring out the force, the true force of the meaning of the things that we, the passages and chapters and verses we read in English. And next week, we're going to look into the real way to say things. Oh, I'm sorry, Bert's trying to come in. Oh, you got her? Okay. Hey. Amen. All kinds of things are going on here. Amen. So, is there anything anyone would like to say, a statement anyone would like to make?
Well, just pray for me for tomorrow with surgery and pray that I can be back at the meeting next week, because I'm having a knee replacement as far as getting up and down the stairs to the computer.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've had some folk that had that done.
Mine's a year old now.
Okay. Yeah. Larry's running and jumping now.
Right. Well.
So it'll be a good thing. It'll be a good thing.
My wife's laughing at me.
Yeah, I see it.
He's running and jumping and praising God.
Amen. Hey, yada tauda. Hallelujah.
Going up and down the steps is what helps.
Oh, amen. Yes. That's what it is. Bonnie, I know you've been working him too. I know you're not letting him sit around on his hands. Amen. Anything anybody would like to say?
Yes, I lost a cousin, first cousin, to cancer.
Oh, my.
Days ago. So just pray for the Harris family.
Okay.
That one of the ones you mentioned, Lisa and
No.
No, it was somebody different?
Oh, no. Her name was Dawn, Stephanie Shedrick.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry to hear that.
She suffered with cancer for 8 years.
Wow.
Man.
Yeah.
Wow.
That suffering.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Reg, can we get a prayer? Everyone pray for my husband, Stephen.
Deacon DeShields.
Yes. Keep him in prayer for him. Heal and mercy that he's feeling well again.
Amen.
Yeah.
Challenged with a few things.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Any other prayer requests for our pastor?
Praying for you, preacher.
Amen. So I'll add him to the
Amen.
List.
Amen.
Add him to the list. Amen.
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 Praying for the Lord, for First Lady.
Yes, ma'am. Pastor Bogan, would you like to have comments and close us out?
Yeah, thank you. Again, thank you for everyone who came on tonight. And as Brother Red says, let's be prayerful. Let's offer sacrifices of praise, the fruit of our lips, giving praise and honor to the glory of God. And remember to pray for all those who just asked for a prayer. And there are others. Brother Gene Davis, please keep him in prayer. Sister Melissa's husband. And Cheryl Rowland is another young lady I've known for many years. And they called today, they text tonight to say that they believe she does not have long. So pray for the Rowland family. And so, Brother Reg, I'm going to defer back to you to close us up in prayer.
Amen. Let's bow. Our Father and our God, in the pure and perfect name of the Lord Jesus the Christ, once again we bow mm-hmm. before your throne of grace and mercy.
Yes,
Lord. Holy Father, we call upon your holy name, Holy Father. We're yes, thankful, God. Holy Father, that we have the privilege that we're able, Holy Father, to seek your face in prayer, Holy Father. We ask now, Holy Father, your healing upon those that were mentioned, upon Deacon Stephen DeShields, Sister Albert and Brother Albert for mm-hmm. their loss. I pray for Reverend Baltimore.
Yes, God.
For his procedure tomorrow.
Yes, Jesus.
Father, you know that the ailments, the pains, the trials, the issues that we have, Holy Father, as we try to walk this Christian pathway.
Jesus.
We're just so thankful, Holy Father, that we know that you lead us and you guide us, Holy mm-hmm. Father. We just pray that we would be more obedient to your call, Holy Father. Yes. We pray and ask, Holy Father, that you would bless each one here and is under the sound of my voice, Holy Father, that we might be able to worship you with an acceptable worship, Holy Father, in spirit and in truth, Holy Father. We're yes. just so thankful for who you are. I pray for each member here, each one under the sound of my voice, Holy Father. I ask that you would administer to their needs, Holy Father, as you said, that you would supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory. And we're just so thankful, Holy Father, for we know you are faithful, Holy Father, to do that which you have promised. So right now, Holy Father, I pray that as we leave this study, that we not leave your presence, Holy Father, but that we continue to do that which is pleasing in your sight. Make us the people you have called us to be. Bless our church, Holy Father. Bless your church, Holy Father, we pray. In the name of the Lord Jesus the Christ, we ask that you would have your way with us all as we go about our everyday living.
Mm-hmm.
Have your way with us, Father, we pray. Thank you for all things. In Jesus' holy name, we pray. And we pray with all thanksgiving. Let us all say amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
God bless you all.
God bless you.
With me, huh. Put your hands.